try to do my best to speak again this morning. Pray for me. I go to see my doctor on Thursday. My arm is killing me. I can hardly lift it, so keep that in prayer. But that's not going to stop me from telling you that the Word of God is alive and powerful. It's sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the dividing asunder of the soul and the spirit and of the joints and the marrow. It's a critic of the thoughts and the intents of the heart. All Scripture is God-breathed. It's profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, so that the man and woman of God may become mature, thoroughly furnished unto all good works. Therefore, study to show yourself approved unto God, a workman that needeth not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. Turn in the word of truth this morning to Galatians chapter 6. This is our 11th message on the doctrine of idolatry. We're almost ready to close the first two commandments and get into the third one. But we are still noting point 5 in our subject, which deals with idolatry and the influence of what we call the Phallic cult. In fact, we closed on Wednesday and Friday evening by noting one manifestation of whether or not we really do love God. And the Apostle Paul brings this out. Look at Galatians chapter 6 in verse 17, where he says, you know what, if we really do love God, there will be certain manifestations in our physical body that reveal that we do. What does he say? Well, look at verse 17. From now on, let no one cause trouble for me. Why? For I bear on my body, not even in his body, but on his body, the brand marks of Jesus. This means that the Apostle Paul, by the way, he wore a badge that marked him out as being the true servant of the Lord Jesus Christ. His badge was a badge of suffering, as we'll see in just a moment. In fact, go to 1 Corinthians chapter 4. He bore in his body the marks of the Lord Jesus, and he tells us that the brand marks that Paul identified with is actually based upon, let's go to 1 Corinthians 4 first, and look at verse 1. Here's what he said to the Corinthian believers. Let a man regard us in this manner. I want you to regard me like this, Paul says, as servants of Christ and stewards of the mysteries of God. By the way, that's a reference to mystery doctrine. If you don't know mystery doctrine, then you don't know what the Christian way of life is all about. You always get people that want to get involved in other things, but not mystery doctrine. They will be losers in the eternal state, and that's sad. So he says, let a man regard us in this manner. We are servants of Christ, and he's talking about him, Titus, and Timothy. We regard us in this manner as servants of Christ, stewards of the mystery doctrines of God. In this case, moreover, it is required of stewards that one be found trustworthy. But to me, it's a very small thing that I should be examined by you. They were judging him and saying he's not qualified to be behind the pulpit. Or he said, it's not only a very small thing that I should be examined by you or by any human court. Why? In fact, I do not even examine myself. He says, the Lord's going to do that. Look at verse 4. For I am conscious of nothing against myself, yet even though I am not by not being conscious of the fact that I may fail in an area, he says, that doesn't mean I'm acquitted, but the one who examines me is who? It's the Lord. Always remember that. Therefore, I dedicate this to anyone who might be critical and concentrating on others. Do not go on passing what? Judgment before the time. But wait until the Lord comes. He will bring to light the things hidden in the darkness. He will disclose the motivation, the motives of men's hearts. And then each man's praise will come to him from who? From God. And I love that because of the fact that all of our praise has to come from God, doesn't it? And if it doesn't come from God, then what are we living here for? We have to realize that all of our praise comes from God. God is the one who, he says, you know what? You have to live for one major reason. Someday you're going to have to stand before me and give an account for yourself. In fact, look at verse 6 in 1 Corinthians 4. He says, now these things happen, these things, brethren, I have figuratively applied to myself and Apollos for your sakes, that in us you might learn not to exceed what is written, in order that no one of you might become arrogant in behalf of one against the other. Don't judge one another. For who regards you as superior? And I love this. What do you have, and what do I have, that we did not what? Receive. How many times do we say, well, you know what, I earned that. No, you did not. There are people in your life that have worked a lot harder than you and a lot harder than me that don't have what you have and don't have what I have. So he says, who regards you as superior? And what do you have that you did not what? Receive, that's from God. But if you did receive it, why do you boast as if you had not received it? You're already filled. You have already become rich. You have become kings without us. He's actually using sarcasm here. And I would indeed that you had become kings so that we all might reign with you. In other words, he's saying, I'd like to share in your victory. For I think, now notice what he said, because if you want to live the spiritual life, look what Paul said. I think God has exhibited us apostles who are number one in the plan of God, aren't they? But it says God has exhibited, he has manifested us as apostles last of all. We look like we're men condemned to death because we have become a spectacle not only to the world but both to angels and to men. We are fools for Christ's sake, but you are prudent in Christ. Sarcasm. We are weak, but you are strong. You are distinguished, but we are without honor. To this present hour, we both hungry, and we're thirsty and poorly clothed and are roughly treated and are homeless. Now, what is he saying? He is saying, let me tell you something, that the plan of God does not include the fact that no matter what we do, we're going to have all fantastic blessings, because he even said in Philippians 1:29, for to you and me it has been granted for Christ's sake, not only to believe in him, but also to what? Suffer for his sake. Do we really want to have that mark on our body, whether it's physically, mentally, or spiritually? Peter put it like this, 1 Peter 2:21, for you have been called for this purpose, since Christ also suffered for you. Amen? You believe that, don't you? How about this? Leaving you an example for you to follow in whose steps? His steps. Colossians 1:24. I rejoice in my sufferings for your sake. In my human body, my flesh, I do my share in behalf of his body, which is the church, in filling up that which is lacking in Christ's afflictions. And then the one I want you to really see, go to the book of Acts chapter 5. Verse 41. When the early church began, they had a lot of problems, a lot of difficulties. Now, we don't really have that in our day and age like they had that in the early days, and we don't have it like they're having it throughout the world, by the way. We live in a great nation and a great society where we're not suffering like they're doing in other areas of the world. But notice what it says in Acts 5:41 about those who were told they should stop preaching about the Christ, the early church. It says, so they went on their way from the presence of the council that said, don't teach Christ, but they were rejoicing. They were going to preach Christ no matter what. They were rejoicing that they had been considered worthy to suffer what? Shame for his name. Now, the description of Paul's sufferings does not apply to us in the sense we're not going to suffer like him. We're not apostles. We didn't live in the early ministry of our Lord's ministry where he changed the world. Think about it. Our Lord changed the world with 12 men. 11 of them, by the way, well, one committed suicide, as you know, Judas. But 11 of them were not really intelligent. And that he changed the world with those people. Now, if he could change the world with those 11, I like what Colonel Thiem used to call them, knuckleheads. Do you think he can actually affect your family life with you as a spiritual knucklehead? Of course. He can use us. In fact, I always like to say it again. He doesn't work because of us. He works in what? In spite of us. There you go. So just as the physical marks branded Paul as one of Christ's slave, and it means that he was the property of Christ because he was beaten, as we already saw that in 2 Corinthians 11. He was a soldier of Christ. He was a follower of Christ. And so this should be upon us spiritual marks that brand us as belonging to Christ. What are those marks? Let me give you 7 of them. I already gave them to you on Friday, or maybe Wednesday or in Friday. I'm going to give them to you rather quickly. Here are the 7 marks of Christ that actually would take place in our life if we are going to glorify God. First of all, number 1, a manifestation of the fruit of the Spirit. Galatians 5:22. Those are the marks in 23. The fruit of the Spirit is what? Love. Love, joy, peace, long-suffering. That's a mark of Christ in your life. You may not see it, but people will see the manifestation of it by the way you treat other individuals. There's also also going to be, number two, a spirit of meekness. If you look at Galatians 6, why don't you go to Galatians, by the way? Look at Galatians 6. I want you to see this in the eye gate, in the ear gate, in verse 1. If you really have a mark of Christ, I'll tell you what you're going to be. You're going to be meek. You're going to be humble. And by the way, when I say you're going to be meek and you're going to be humble, I'm telling you, if you agree with me, I don't like being meek and humble. I like being arrogant and bad. But that's my flesh. I can't do that. Amen? And you have no idea what I did last evening, but you would be shocked if I told you. It was all good. And it had to do with praying for members of my congregation. You know when the Bible says pray for your enemies? You really got to do that. What it does is you're going to take the offering this morning. Deacon Robert Tavares, he knows what I mean by this. But we do have to have a spirit of meekness, don't we? And be gentle. And the people that we have to be meek and gentle toward are those that we don't want to be meek and gentle toward. That's why Paul said, brethren, if any man is caught in any trespass, you also who are what? Spiritual. What should you do? Tell all the church about what they've done that's wrong. Don't use them at all. Don't let them sing in the choir. Don't let them serve as a deacon. Don't let them serve in the local assembly. Just put them down. No, it says even if they're caught in a trespass, you who are spiritual, what are you to do? Restore such a one in a spirit of gentleness, or, by the way, humility, each one looking to yourself, lest you too also be what? Tempted. Always remember that. That's a sign, by the way, of the marks of Christ. Thirdly, the marks of Christ in our bodies is also willingness to share what others are going through, their burdens. Look at Galatians 6:2. We're told to what? Bear one another's burdens. If we do, we fulfill the law of Christ. And I'm going through these rather quickly. If you want more of it, go on the internet and you can get that. And by the way, Pastor Rick Kabrick every week writes a Tree of Life. And the Tree of Life was a capstone of what I taught all week long. So that's a good way to catch up quickly. But that should not stop you from still listening to the message. But number four, there's also a willingness to help and support those who minister. Galatians 6:6. I already went into that. I'm not going to mention it this morning. Do what you want. By the way, I want to say thank you. The money for the books have come in. Thank you very much. And I just want to say a big thank you, especially to the state of Texas, because a lot of it came from there. And thank you for that. Texas, we still love you, even though you're not as great as the Yankees or the New England Patriots or all the other teams up here. But just hang in there. Someday you might be good. But anyway, thank you. Thank you, not just Texas. Thank you for all of those on the internet who stopped me from having to get up here and saying, we need 1,700. Now we need 1,500. Now we need 1,300. Now we need nothing when it comes to those books. But there's some other needs that will come up, I'm sure, but that's not what we're about this morning, right? But there should be, if you have a mark of Christ, you should have a willingness to help support those who minister to others. Galatians 6:6, look at it. Let the one who is taught the word koinonia, Friday night, if you don't know what I meant by koinonia, that's sad. You should, but that just simply means you haven't been listening up to date to what I've been teaching. But let the one who is taught the word koinonia all good things with the one who teaches. Number five, another mark of Christ is a life made up of doing what? Good. Look at Galatians 6:10. So then, while we have opportunity, let us what? Do what? Good, that's divine good, to all men, not just to those that we like. And then he goes on to make a distinction, especially those who are of the household of faith. Number six, there should be a complete separation from the world. Galatians 6:12-13. And then number seven, if you have the mark of Christ, you should glory in the cross. Look at Galatians 6:14. But may it never be that I should boast. Boast about what? That I should boast except about anything except in the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ, through which the cross, the world, the cosmic system of Satan, and all the desires and all the lies that Satan promotes has been crucified to me. It's dead to me. When something's crucified, it means it's dead to you. So you can go after what the world says you need to be successful, or you can say, this is dead to me. And he says, not only is it dead to me, but I am dead to the what? To the what? to the world. So before we conclude our fifth point, idolatry and the influence of the Phallic cult in Amsad, well, I'm not really sad. I'm happy that it came out today, but you'll see why. I have to define, first of all, the word cult for you. I'm going to give you the Webster's New 20th Century Dictionary. The second edition says this: what is a cult? And we're calling it the Phallic cult. Now remember, I said the Phallic cult is around right now today. But it's not called the Phallic cult. It's called something else, as we will see this morning. But again, the Webster's New 20th Century Dictionary, second edition, says a cult means devoted attachment to or an extravagant admiration for a person, a principle, or a thing. Let me say it again. What is a cult? It means you're devoted. You have a devoted attachment to or an extravagant admiration for a person, a principle, or a thing. Notice that a cult is described, as Pastor Rick Kabrick brought out, as being devotedly attached to something. Have an extreme admiration for that thing, whether it's a person, a principle, or a thing. The Webster's New College Dictionary also says this, that a cult is a great devotion to a person, idea, or thing, especially such devotion regarded as literary or intellectually fad or mania. It means that's the system that everybody's saying today. Like I had an individual call me today, well, yesterday, and he said to me, how can I say this? He said, should I marry this individual? I said, why do you want to marry that individual? Well, we're living together. Well, whatever told you that living together is right in the eyes of God? If you're living together with the person of the opposite sex, hopefully if you're, if you're living together with the opposite sex, but if you have an attachment to someone in that situation, what's the best thing to do? Either marry the person or get out of the situation. Don't leave yourself in a place where you're going to be tempted, right? You got to make a decision. Because if not, you're going to start saying, well, everybody's doing it. Everybody says, well, try it out. Try what out? Well, you know, live together for about a year or two and see if you guys can get along to get married. No, that's not the eyes of God. In the eyes of God, God says, for this cause a man shall leave his father and mother, and the two shall become what? One. And they shall leave the others, and they shall live for each other. God desired one man for one woman. Adam and Eve, not Adam and Steve, as you heard before. Adam and Eve. Now you have to make a decision. So the issue is, what are you devoted to? As you can see, a cult is not necessarily a devotion to a god. Just because we say someone's involved in a cult, that doesn't mean they're involved with a god as such. It can also mean a devotion to an idea. Let's try it out. Let's do the world's way of thinking. Like someone said to me, they're going to try out this new soup. Why? Oprah Winfrey said it's a new soup. You got to try out here a new soup. Why? Everybody's going to go flocking to that. They listen to the cosmic system. You're being devoted to an idea, especially one set up by the God of this world, 2 Corinthians 4:4, who is Satan himself. Now you must remember, who knows the human race better than any other human being with the exception of our Lord? Satan does. He knows us better than we even know ourselves. And he knows that one of the most basic needs in the human race is the need to be what? Loved. How many of you don't want to be loved here this morning? It's a need to be appreciated. You got it? A need to be wanted. He knows that. So what is he going to do about that? He's going to come up with a plan. Unfortunately, here's where the kingdom of darkness has done its best to deceive thousands of Christians, by the way, even Christians and, of course, the world. If you are a normal member of the human race, do you want to be loved? Of course. Do you want to be appreciated? Of course. Do you want to be wanted? Of course. If you're normal, you want to be loved, appreciated, and wanted. Now, here comes the cult. Here comes the deception. Bear with me. One of the main reasons why the Phallic cult is still around today is because most individuals do not understand the difference between natural desires and lust. Very, very important. Notice that again. Do you know the difference between a natural desire and a lust? Now go to Ephesians 4, verse 17. I'm going to show you how Satan has taken the natural desires that we have, that God placed within us, and he's perverted those to make it lust instead of desires. In fact, as we're going to see this morning again, as I have taught you in the past, that the same word translated I desire is also translated I lust in the Word of God. That's why you have to go back to the original language. I have no idea why someone can say, how someone can say, I really don't like the studying that goes on. I want more of the Holy Spirit. You can't have more of the Holy Spirit than the Word of God. Because in the beginning was the Word was with God, and the Word was what? God. So to say I want more of the Holy Spirit and not God is inconsequential. It doesn't make sense. You can't have the Holy Spirit without having the Word of God. God said in Psalm 56, praise His Word. Psalm 56, and He said it twice, praise God's Word. If you don't praise His Word, you're not going to praise God. And so notice what Paul said in Ephesians 4:17. He says this to the Ephesians, by the way, who were involved and influenced by the Phallic cult, which said you can go after sex all you want, because you see, all of us, if you're normal, you want to be loved, you want to be appreciated, you want to be wanted. God has placed those desires within us. He's placed the desire even to have sex within us. But that doesn't mean if we don't have it, we're wrong. It just simply means we're going to do it God's way and not the ways of the world. Satan has a way to lie to us. He says, you can have these desires met, but you can have them my way. Forget about what the Word of God says. You can have them my way. Live for yourself. Do what you want to do. You really do have a desire to be loved, don't you? You really do have a desire to be appreciated and needed, don't you? Of course I do. Well, I'll tell you how to have it, Satan says. Have it my way, not God's way. God's way is too strict. No, God is the creator. He's the one that created those desires that we have. So why get condemned because those desires are within you? And I'm going to show you this morning, if I get that far, because I don't know how much time I have. I'm already 11:05. I'm going to try to show you this morning how the legitimate desires that you have, even for sex, there's nothing wrong with that whatsoever, providing that you realize that there's one way to have those desires met. God's way. Satan comes in and says, wait, I got the Phallic cult. What's the Phallic cult? It's the worship of the male phallus. What's the male phallus? Well, some of you parents tell your children what that is. I'll just quickly say penis. Now let's go on. Ephesians 4:17. This I say, therefore, I affirm together with the Lord that you walk no longer just as the unbelievers, the Gentiles also walk in the emptiness, the futility of their mind. They're darkened in their understanding. They are excluded from the life of God. Notice they're darkened where? In their understanding. That's their mind. They're excluded from the life of God. God dwells within His body, by the way, within His church. And they are darkened and they're excluded from the life of God because of the what that's in them? Ignorance. Where did they get that from? The cosmic system. The liar. The devil. He's a liar, John 8:44. But even worse than that, he's also a murderer. He desires, if he cannot get you to come on his side, he will try to murder you because he knows that the gates of hell cannot prevail against you if you stick with the plan. So it says they're darkened in their understanding. They're cut off. Excluded means they're cut off from the life of God because they have listened to ignorance, because of the ignorance that is in them, because of the hardness of their heart. That means your heart has become hard. We have people that are missing here this morning. You know why? Their heart has become hard. Scar tissue. They no longer want God's word. They want something else. Give me feeling. Give me emotion. Give me more of something that's not going to change my life. Because let me tell you something. If you're on a hospital bed and you're facing death, you're not going to be saying, I'm going to speak in tongues right now. That will give me the ability to get through this. I'm going to get slain in the Spirit. I'm going to dance in the Holy Spirit and walk, and I'm going to feel the Holy Spirit. No, you're going to be all by yourself. And you're going to walk through that valley of the shadow of death. And the only thing you're going to realize is that He's with you. Not tongues, not water baptism, not all the nonsense that goes on in Christianity, like being slain. I don't even know, you know when they got slain from the Spirit? They said, well, when Paul was knocked off the horse, that was being slain by the Holy Spirit. That means that you touch them and they fall. When that happened, Paul was arrogant. He was an unbeliever. He wasn't filled with the Holy Spirit. God was trying to get his attention. Don't get involved in all that nonsense. It will take you away from the real reason that you were here. So Paul says they're darkened in their understanding. They're cut off from the life of God because of the ignorance that is in them and because of the hardness of their heart. And they haven't become, not careless, C-A-R-E-L-E-S, callous. That means they've got callous on their heart. They've got scar tissue on their soul. They're not excited about the Word of God. Remember when you had people, for example, look at your left, look at your right. Don't do it right now, but remember there were people here that used to sit right next to you and they were excited about the Word of God? What happened? All of a sudden they were like, well, go to Luke chapter 8. Let me show you this. God, the Holy Spirit's already changing this, so I might as well just go with the flow, right? You want to hear what the Spirit has to say, not just what I want to say. Amen to that. Listen to what the Spirit says to who? To the churches. Look at Luke 8. He says this. He says, when it says in verse 4, Luke 8, 4, when a large crowd was coming together and those from the various cities were journeying to him, he spoke by way of a parable. And here's what he said. The sower went out to sow his seed. And as he sowed, some fell beside the road, some seed beside the road, and it was trampled underfoot. The birds of the air ate it up. So that seed's dead. Other seed fell on rocky soil. And as soon as it grew up a little bit, they heard the word of God. It withered what? Away, because it had no moisture, nothing to keep it going. Moisture means the word of God, because the word of God is translated as water. Other seed fell among the what? The thorns are the problems, the difficulties, and the thorns grew up with it and choked it out. Other seed fell into a good soil and grew up, and they produced a crop 100 times as great. And he said these things he would call out to hear as to what the mysteries are. Seeing they are against the name of the word. Those who have heard, they heard the word. Remember, you brought them to Bible class, many of you, didn't you? But then what happened? The devil comes and takes away the word from their heart. That's garbage. That's nonsense. Don't listen to him. What's he talking about? He wants your money. Thank God we don't charge for anything, because you can't say, we want your money. And so what does it say? The devil comes, takes away from the word, takes the word from their heart by giving them wrong viewpoint, by the way, so that they will not believe and be what? Saved. Those on the rocky soil are those who have heard, and when they hear, they receive the word of God with what? Joy. Pastor, I'm here. Oh, what can I do to serve? What can I do to honor God? I'm here. I'm excited. This is the place God has called me to be. Well, what does it say? On the rocky soil are those who, when they hear, they receive the word with what? Joy. But they have no firm root. They believe for a while, and in time of temptation, they what? They fall away. The seed which fell among the thorns are those who have heard, and they go on their way. And as they go on their way after hearing, they are choked with the worries and the riches and the pleasures of this life. I'm worried about tomorrow, as Pastor Rick said, don't worry about tomorrow. And they're worried about tomorrow. They're worried about riches and pleasures of this life, but they bring no what? Fruit. They don't have the marks of Christ to maturity. But the seed in the good soil, these are the ones that we live for, the ones that we're grateful for. Instead of saying, gee, the glass is half empty, how about saying the glass is half full? Instead of saying, gee, why isn't someone not coming any longer? How about saying, thank God that the ones I brought are still coming. Thank God my family's still here. You know, I was looking out, that something happened. I'll just tell you this. I got to close because I know that it's getting late, but I had ordered some food from an Asian restaurant yesterday, and the guy came, and outside my grandson, Alex, John Medeiros is my son. Well, he's my son-in-law, but I call him my son. He has a son, Alex. He's my grandson. He has a baby called Noah, as many of you know, new baby. And I said to the Asian guy, I said, you know what? I said, what a blessing it is. I said, you came here today, and I said, you realize that out there, there's three generations. I said, there's my sons, there's my grandson, and there's my great-grandson, right? Is that true? Great-grandson. He goes, wow. And he says, and you don't even look a year over 70. So I just looked at myself and said, thank you. You know, gave him a tip, walked away and said, 70? And I don't know why I'm telling you that story. All I know is that, you know, sometimes you just say, you know what, thank God for those who stay. And I said, thank God that I have the ability to walk out and I can see three generations of my family outside. What a blessing that is, isn't it? Thank God that you heard a mother sing before I spoke. And then, are you going to sing this morning? Who's doing the offering? Well, thank God we have a mother and a daughter that sing. Do what you want to do. But anyway, isn't it great that we do have the fact that there are individuals in our life that when the Word of God does spring up, they're still with us? And I don't care if their doctrinal views are different, right? We're all going to the same place. We're all going to be living with each other forever and ever. Why not get along now? So when we go to heaven, we'll find out who's right. You're going to find out, yeah, when I get to heaven, yeah, Pastor was right. Pastor Bob was right, and I was wrong. You'll find that out, but I have the grace to actually go through that. All I know is this. I'm grateful to our Lord and Savior that He's given me the ability to have a congregation like this and have a family like I have, and I'm going to focus in on the fact that instead of the glass being half empty, it's really half full. And I'm going to expect God to do even more. Isn't that great? So being docked in their understanding, having being excluded from the life of God because of the ignorance that is in them, because of the hardness of the heart, they have become callous. They've given themselves over to sensuality for the practice of every kind of impurity with greediness. And he says this, but you did not learn what? Christ in this way. And I wish I had you. I wish I could go into this morning. I don't have time. It's 11:15. I don't want to keep you and take you away from what I really want to teach. I'll get into this more on Wednesday. All I do want to tell you is that it's very important that you understand the fact that there's a difference between a desire and a lust. And just because you desire certain things and you want it, that doesn't mean you're lusting. It's when you allow a lust or some negative feeling to take control of you that it becomes wrong. If you stick with the plan of God, someday you'll do what I did yesterday. I walked out on my porch that my family helped me get, a beautiful home and a beautiful house that they helped me get. And I walked out and I looked at three generations of people and I said, what a blessing. And I looked at the glass as being half full, not half empty. And God said, you know all those desires you had, Pastor Bob? And I said, yeah. He goes, they weren't wrong. They were desires I placed within you. They become wrong when you turn them into lust and you say, I want them to be fulfilled according to my way. I want them now. God says, you wait on my timing. And in my timing, I will fulfill all things. And I love what David said. I thought about teaching on this morning in Psalm, I think it was 39. He says, I've been old and I've been young. I've been old, young and I've been old. And he said, one thing I've learned, I've never been forsaken by the Almighty God. And I don't know about you, but I can say the same thing. I've been young, I've been old. I've been down, I've been up, and I've been down. I've been a winner, and I've been a loser. But I'll tell you what, no matter what I've been, He always there. Amen. I know it sounds like Pentecostal there or something, but it doesn't matter. But isn't He always there? Didn't He say, I'll never leave you or forsake you? Didn't He say, I'll go with you to the end of the world? How about someday just wake up and say, I'm going to Bible class this morning to do what? To just praise Him. To just thank Him for what I have. I'm not going to get so involved in my personal life that I'm wondering, how am I going to handle my problems? I'm going to handle my problems because I know one verse that says, I can do all things through Him who keeps on strengthening me. That's our Lord. That's our Savior. That's what we should focus in on. And every now and then, we need a little build up like this morning. That's why I love like Pastor Rick Kabrick. He goes, I hope I'm going to do good this morning. I hope they're going to like me. I said, Rick, stop it. I said, you're involved with what they think about you. I said, it's what God thinks about you. And he goes, you know what? You're right. I said, Rick, you've done an amazing job. Focus in on how God has used you. The glass in your life is half full. It's not half empty. And that's because of all the other people in our life that have a glass that's half full, like you folks, and not half empty. And that's why I can stand before you and say, gee, we needed like, what, $4,000 2 weeks ago. We don't charge raw material, yet God actually blessed people, and those people blessed us, and that's why we're still here as a local assembly. Give the Lord a nice praise, a nice clap. Father, thank you for the power of your word this morning. And Father, we do pray that if there's anyone here that's never listened to you before, or never heard you before, or heard the gospel before, or maybe they are listening by the internet. If you've never believed in Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, now's the time to do so. You can tell God, Father, I recognize I'm a sinner, and I recognize my need to be saved. So, Father, I'm believing on your Son, Jesus Christ, because your word says, according to the pastor, according to other people in my life, that if I believe upon your Son, I can be saved. I'm trusting that, and I want to become a part of eternal life. So bless me, Father, as I now enter into fellowshipping with you and learning about you because of the fact that you've offered me your salvation. If you've done that, I'm here to tell you, you are a child of God, and you don't have to worry about the difference between desires and lusts. God will teach you that as time goes on. Just find yourself a Bible-believing church that teaches the truth of the Word of God, and then enjoy your life. Father, bless the remainder of this service, for we ask it in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and our Savior, we do pray. Amen. Thank you. Thank you very much. Deacon Robert Tavares, come on up here.
Excuse me?
Who was ever getting ready to sing?
Okay. I don't know who's going to sing, but you can get ready. Yeah, you can come up stage. All right, royal family. All right, so you're going to sing. All right. It's time for the offering. I always come over here and get to, you know, crazy end guys. But for those who are on the internet, I thank you very much for the faithfulness of your giving. And, you know who you are. And it will, and God is not an unjust God. He knows you have, if you honor Him and things like that, He will not forget you. You will get what what God wants to give you more than wherever you're taught. My wife and we were talking about Elijah, and we were talking about the different gods, and the people of Israel were worshiping Baal at that time, and there was 450 prophets, if I'm not mistaken, and there was only Elijah against them, and they had a big drought, and there was no water, and they were complaining, it's your fault, Elijah, this and that, Elijah. So let's put this to rest. You guys take an ox, and we're going to do an offering to the Lord. And and the 450 prophets put their offer and ox on top of their altar, and they worship, and then they were worshiping God, their God, and said, and he says, oh, can you, make it loud, maybe he's not listening to you, and they'll listen back and forth. What I seen is these 450 prophets, the people of Israel, worshiping their gods. One man stood, and he says, he puts the offering, and he went further than that. He made a ditch around, he put seed on it, and he asked, bring four containers of water, pour over the offering. And he said, pour it another time, and another time, three times. So when it is a drought, there's two things we don't do. You don't waste water, and you don't pour seed away. You just hold it until the water comes, then you seed, and you get the water. But there's a man, he understood God. When it comes to offering, understand who God is. It's not a time for you to give now because, in a sense of, I got to give. No, understand who God is. And there you will get your strength to give the right way. That you don't be a man of your word and you say, oh, I'm going to give, and tomorrow a problem comes and you don't give. You're like tossed and forward, back and forth. Understand who God. Grow in God. And there you will have your strength. Elijah knew, he put the seed, and he worshiped God. And there the fire came and consumed, and God approved of him. And after he says to his servant, go and see and look. As he looked into the sky, he saw, oh, I see a little cloud as big as a hand. And he says, go again and see. And all of a sudden the rain came and God blessed him. That's the only thing I have to say. Honor God. Learn who he is. He will not forsake you. Then you can give from a place of strength. Let us bow our heads. Heavenly Father, we want to thank you for another day. We have come here to worship you. We come here to hear your word. And now the offering, I pray that you bless your people, Lord. Those who give faithfully, continue to bless them. And those who have struggled with that, I pray that they will come to understand who you are. And there they will give what is true power of your strength to understand who you are. In Jesus' name I pray, amen.
That was awesome. So A couple weeks ago, I was at a deacon's meeting, and I made this announcement last week, but I kind of just want to touch on it again. Good job, Nicole. I want to touch on this again, just for those that either weren't here or anyone who maybe is thinking about helping out. When I was at that meeting, kind of a hot topic was that there's a void in this church with like an area of serving. And what it falls on is the leaders and people who are kind of overseers of certain ministries. And when things fall on them, it really takes away from their area. You know, and I know we have people out here who are willing to help, willing to serve, but they might not know what area they can help in or what area they can serve. Maybe they don't feel like they have a skill or have an ability to really help, but they have a willing heart. You know, when Jesus was walking along the Sea of Galilee and he saw Peter and he saw Andrew, you know, they were just fishermen. And he said, "Come with me and I'll make you fishers of men." And they didn't question him. They didn't say, "Well, you know, we're just fishermen, we can't really do anything." Now they dropped their nets immediately and they ran to him because they knew that with the willing heart they had, if they followed Jesus, that he could use them to change the world. You know, you might be a carpenter, you might be, you know, someone who could be an electrician, or might not feel like you can do any of that. But it's the willing heart that really matters. You know, if you look at the carpets here, they're always perfect because we have Robert who vacuums them after every service. If you look at all the trash, you've never seen one full because we always have people to empty that. You know, we have, right. So kind of to wrap up, if you have a willing heart and you have the ability to serve, just come see me after service. I want to put you on a list. And when we have a need that comes up, you know, we'll send an email out. And if that's something you want to do, just respond and then we can help. You can help in that area. So just see me after service if you want to help out and you want to serve. Thank you.
Thank you, Bryson. Yes. All right. We're not going to hold you up any longer, but I just want to say something quick. You can stop me, Pastor. After. You know, I speak with my children a lot, and my sons, and yesterday we were speaking about how there's this great movement now about young people. They don't just want to come to church anymore. They want to learn the Word of God, and they want it to be backed up by Scripture. That's what we have here. That's what we've always had here. Thank God for that, right? You know, that movement is going to change, just like in many other movements, but I'm just so proud of this church because we've always done what God's told us to do, teach the Word of God. And I'm so proud of our pastor for that. And whether that movement is true and here to stay and problematic, other movements will come, but we will always do what God tells us to do. Now, I know I'm, like many of you, I'm unskilled in speaking, but not in knowledge. There's a lot in here, believe it or not. There really is, because of that man, because of our God. And I know all of you, hopefully, have the same knowledge, because that's what keeps us going. So let's just stay occupied with Christ. Let's not let the world get the best of us this week. Let's stand strong and let's bow our heads, please. Father, thank you again for this great church, for teaching us your word, Father, for keeping us strong. May you bless the remainder of this day, Father. And we ask and thank you for all these things in the name of your precious Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. You are dismissed.